Former Prime Minister Malcolm Fraser is never far from controversy, but at least he's fair. He criticises both sides of politics. We'll meet him soon, but first, here's a snapshot of his six decades in public life. At just 25, Malcolm Fraser was elected the youngest member of Federal Parliament in 1955. 20 years later, he became caretaker Prime Minister when Gough Whitlam was dismissed and the Fraser-led coalition won the next election in a landslide. He left politics after Bob Hawke's resurgent Labor Party won office in 1983. But Malcolm Fraser has never stopped contributing to public life in Australia and overseas. He's criticised both sides of politics for their stance on asylum seekers.
Politicians are playing on a nerve that's easily aroused, fears easily built up to quite serious levels.
And he continues to speak out, recently labelling Australia's defence ties with America as un-Australian. Ita is speaking with Malcolm Fraser now. Ita, it's over to you.
Thank you, Sarah. Malcolm Fraser, good morning and welcome to Studio 10.
Thank you very much. Good morning.
In your book, Dangerous Allies, you caution against Australia automatically aligning with the United States. American warplanes have made their first strikes against ISIS and, as we've heard, extremists in Iraq, and our troops are on their way. What are your thoughts now about this?
Well, events in the Middle East are one thing, but I'm most concerned with our relationship, defence relationship with the United States, because of the real possibility of major conflict in the Pacific theatre. And our defence relationship in the Pacific has become so close to the Americans that if they went to war and we said, no, we're going to pass this one by, we're not going to be involved, it just would not be believable. Too much of our own defence platforms, our own defence planning, our own facilities are now used by the Americans. And if an Australian Prime Minister got up and, you know, let's say a conflict was started between Japan and China, which would automatically draw in America, and they started to use those troops in Darwin, or the offensive capacity of Pine Gap, an Australian Prime Minister could get up and say, well, we're not going to be part of it. But nobody would believe him, so we would be part of it,
and
just because the Americans.
Malcolm, I think you made the point that America would automatically go with Japan, but, you know, we might want to still remain friends with China, and you're suggesting that America could drag us to war.
Yes, because of the arrangements made between our defence forces, because we're giving a home to that very powerful multi-service task force at Darwin, and also because the purposes for which Pine Gap is used has changed. It used to be defensive, but now information from Pine Gap is used to aim to target a variety of modern weapon systems, and that makes it an offensive facility, and, you know, that's changed its character totally.
Well, putting that to one side for the moment, do you agree with the Prime Minister Abbott's decision to deploy our military to fight the Islamic State?
I don't really believe in that particular context he had much option. But I would like to think we'd had better advice about the new government in Iraq, because if it cannot act cohesively and build one nation out of Kurd, Sunni and Shia, activity from the air alone will not succeed. And you can say much the same in relation to Syria. If IS is going to be destroyed, they have to be destroyed in Iraq and in Syria. And in Syria, apparently the Americans are relying on rearming and re-equipping the rebels who have been pushed aside, made virtually irrelevant by what's now become ISIS, and to rely on them to carry the ground war, I think might be relying on you know, something that's quite ineffective.
It's a very uneasy world. It's a very uneasy world that we live in, isn't it? And then Middle East unrest threatens the rest of the world. But if we could just move along a little bit. You've been very critical of Tony Abbott's description, Team Australia. What do you think Robert Menzies would think of his Liberal Party today, bearing in mind you quit it in 2010?
Well, Menzies took the first step towards ending the White Australia policy in 1954 by signing on to the Refugee Convention. Later on, his government moved further away and Harold Holt further still and ended the White Australia policy. I think Menzies believed in a multicultural society. He certainly believed in the rule of law, and I know he believed in the Refugee Convention. Well, what's happened, what the government has done and what the opposition has done, is totally at odds with that convention in today's world.
You mean with their attitude to the current arrival of boat people? When you were Prime Minister, the Vietnamese boat people began to arrive in Australia back in 1978. Many of them were illegal. We seem to be able to accept boat people back in your Prime Minister's time. Why do you think we now have this attitude, this very lack of compassion we seem to have in Australia for asylum seekers?
I believe that a redneck nerve has been scratched by government and by opposition. It started as a result of Tampa, when boat people were named as illegals, queue jumpers, terrible people, might be prostitutes, could be drug runners, even terrorists. And if you get a succession of ministers or governments saying that a certain class or group of people are terrible people, then obviously out in the wider community there are many who will, you know, agree with that. In the days of the exodus from Indochina, which was very much greater than anything we've experienced since, you know, the government was saying the opposite, and we had a bipartisan policy. Gough Whitlam did not oppose the policy. And, you know, that was critical, really, to its success.
You've been described as a late-blooming radical, which is a rather nice accolade, I think. What do you think of Prime Minister Abbott's performance so far?
Well, I suppose it depends what part he's taken trying to recover from the problems in with that Malaysian aircraft shot down in the Ukraine. I think all of that has gone pretty well. I perhaps would have moderated some comments in relation to Russia, but the efforts to help Australian families who'd suffered as a consequence of that crash, I would have thought have been well received. And his response in relation to ISIS is something which I believe Australia ought to participate in, but I would like greater assurance that there is going to be Arab support, Arab troops on the ground, and that so far we have no more than a total silence on that subject. So he's governing in difficult times at the moment.
Malcolm Fraser, it's been good talking with you today. Your book, Dangerous Allies, makes very interesting reading. Thank you for being on Studio 10.
Thank you very much. Thank you.